Hello, everyone. So I had a beautiful opportunity to get a chance to be just in the midst of God's creation a little bit earlier today. And I was able to see all of the trees and all of the beauty and the grass. And it was raining. So I got to hear the rain just beautifully hit the ground in such an awesome way, and to see how it just rained so much that the trails of water just created these pathways. And it was almost breathtaking, you know, when you can see something on maybe the Nature Channel or just a picture that you just can hardly believe is real. Is that a real photo? You know, one of those opportunities, one of those circumstances where you just see the creation of God and the glory of God, and you just are in awe of how He puts these things together. Everything that I saw around me, it was beautiful. The colors, especially we're in fall now, so you see the different colors and how the trees are adjusting to it. And so I just began to look at this, and as I was there, I walked to an area where there was actually a wall where something had to be posted. And on the posting, on the letter or the note, it said, "Hey, if you know anyone that has experienced these things, these types of things, really horrible things, if you know anybody going through these matters, please immediately don't be quiet. Reach out." And it just kind of took me by surprise, because I thought this was going to be some other type of notice, maybe a reservation or something else. I thought it was going to be something else. And when I read it, I just began to think on it. I said, wow, all of this beauty, all of the vast creation that just really captivated my attention, just took me just in awe. Underneath all of that, these things were going on. I won't go into naming them, but you can imagine the things that go on in different societies that are just bad. Underneath all of that, you would never know, just sitting here and relaxing and just taking in the refreshing of the Lord, you wouldn't really know that behind the scenes, these bad things are happening. You wouldn't really know that there are people crying out because they're experiencing horrible things in their lives and they need help. And I begin to think about how so many people can be in that same way, really being able to see those circumstances afar off and say, man, we need to pray. We need to pray for them. They need help. Or see someone that is beautiful on the outside, but have a personality. You know, sometimes we look at Facebook and I see the profiles. These filters really do us a number, don't they? That you can know somebody in person, and then when their profile picture goes across your screen, you can say, wow, if I didn't know that person, I would think that they were this way based on how they present themselves, based on their pose, based on their picture, based on everything they're able to put on the outside. But man, I feel sorry for the people that just, you know, reach out to them and get to know them and want to marry them based on how they look. Because that's not who they are. I know them personally. I know what's going on the inside. At least I know what I've experienced. And I know that that's how the Lord sees us. See, He makes His creation beautiful. He even says He makes everything beautiful in His time. And with us, He delights in our beauty, how He made us, how He created us. He wants us to be for Him. That's why He says He created us in His likeness and His image. And that's also why it gives Him pleasure to give us His grace, to give us His mercy, to give us and pour out His love on us. That's why it's a delight for Him to pour out His power on us. And it's wonderful that He actually allows His very presence to be on the sons of God, where you can be anointed. You can be anointed to dream visions and dream dreams that are from Him, from His heart. You can be anointed to be able to look at someone and to discern exactly what they are dealing with. You can be anointed for the Lord to speak a prophetic word to you, or for you to actually read His word. You know, it is a gift to understand what the Bible is saying and to be able to reiterate it and to minister it to the heart of a person. That's a gift. That is the anointing of God on your life. And so He pours out His power. And even when you may experience worship, you may experience great measures of his glory. The glory is the weight of his presence on your life. He may be pouring out supernatural rain on you, or even divine power and fire. You may feel it in your body, the shaking of his presence or his angelic presence around where you are. When you worship, you may know that he shows up. That's the power of God. He's making you beautiful, and it is glorious to him. And we can relish in that. And it is a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. And last night, a group of ladies, we were talking about how we know how to do and to experience the things on the outside and to present ourselves. But sometimes we forget that the Lord is looking deeply on the inside of us, and he really wants to reconcile the outside with the inside. He wants to do that. He wants to make sure that we are one person. And it is very easy for you and I to look at someone else and say, hey, you have this issue. I want you to fix this. You need to change this. You need to be more this way. Okay? It's very easy for us to shake our fingers or our heads at somebody that is not, that's somebody that's outside of us, that's not us. It's very easy to see their issues. And then you have the scripture where the Lord says, hey, get the beam out of your own eye. Don't, before you want to go ahead and pluck out of somebody else's eye, get the beam out of your own eye. And that scripture has always stood out to me among others, because he's saying, wait, you know, the beam and a log, isn't that the same thing? That they're very similar. They may not always be the exact same thing, but they're very similar. And sometime across that concept, the Lord teaches us that when you can identify things in someone else's life, that's a good thing. But it's not always a good thing for you to point a finger and wag your finger at them. It's for you to intercede, but also then to turn your fingers inward. Okay, if I notice that about them, what maybe then is the Lord trying to show me about myself? What is it that the Lord wants me to be able to grow in humility and meekness and love? Because I can have the power of God, but if I don't have the personality to house the power of God, then it's all wasted. You know the scripture. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Who is that speaking to? That's speaking to the pastors, the preachers, the teachers, the ministers. That's speaking to those of faith, the believers. That's speaking to those, the prophets. It's speaking to the sons of God who know how to win souls, who know how to love people and to help people and to make people feel better and bring them comfort, that have gifts that bless people in hospitality. That's talking to those people. How you've blessed people, you've helped people, you've known people. You may have prayed for them and seen their healing. And he says, but wait a minute. How can those same people do all that and lose their own soul? Because day by day, I have allowed for them to experience life. I've allowed for them to experience helping people, counseling people, advising people, ministering to people, opening their homes to people day by day by day, allowing them to be an open vessel to me for others, like a hose, just a vessel for the Lord to pour out his goodness and his love for other people. And yet they did not obtain it for themselves for change. They didn't obtain it for themselves to allow themselves to put away the old man, to put away the hatred and the bitterness and the unforgiveness and the selfishness, to put away the hardness of heart, to put away the areas of greed and lust. They didn't utilize the power of God when they're ministering. They didn't listen to their own words and take it for them from the Lord in order to exercise change and the power that he pours out. They didn't go forth and utilize that power so that it can change your character. So now they got holes in their vessel. Just enough for that which the Lord is pouring out to use them to bless and to help others. But they themselves didn't allow themselves to be washed clean. Maybe they were comparing themselves among others. Maybe they allowed envy to consume them. Maybe they got so discouraged that they felt like they didn't know how to come up out of it. Maybe they just got so self-conscious and insecure about themselves that they didn't know how to go to God for the change. Or maybe they did not have the humility that it took to actually go to God and allow him to expose those inner parts until they were totally undone. And God said, this is what I wanted This is what I wanted from you, a totally yielded vessel, so I can really heal those deep areas and show you that they exist. To show you why you are the way that you are. Show you why you are a self-preserved person. Show you why you protect yourself in these ways. Show you why you respond in these manners. Show you why it hurts so much when people say these things or do these things around you instead of pushing them down and sweeping them under the rug and pretending that you're okay. Yeah, you're beautiful on the outside. All that power, all that glory, you're strong. You look so manly. You don't even look like a boy anymore. The Lord has brought you up. You have everything that you've ever wanted. Except on the inside, the reason why there's envies and strives is because on the inside, you still need to be washed. You still need to put away those areas to allow the Lord to clean you up, to allow the Lord to come in and say, let my light just come in and illuminate and to burn up those areas that you still struggle with that maybe no one else knows, that are the areas of your heart that still kind of slip out every now and then. You know, that sarcasm, that's that slippage of pride. You know, those little side remarks or those jokes or those things where you just kind of slip out. Those are those areas that you just kind of, oh, oops, I didn't know I was still hurting. And maybe I didn't even hear myself say that. Or I didn't know I was still offended at those areas. I thought I had forgiven, but I didn't even realize that I said that. But God knows. And he's saying, just come a little closer to me. Because I'm glad that I get to use you, but sometimes I need you to pull back. I need you to come closer to me because there are areas of you that don't fear me enough, that don't reverence my presence enough. Yes, God, I am good. I am kind. I'm merciful. I am patient. I endure. I am enduring towards you. And not only that, my mercy endures. I'm temperate. I am faithful. I am, but I am faithful more to myself, my name, than I am to you. And I, God, need you to know that I am God and I am to be reverenced and I am good and I'm holy. And only those who are willing to be washed and cleaned up, only those who are willing to walk in meekness, willing to get rid of the bitterness, willing to walk in constant forgiveness and gentleness, whether you are male or female, you're willing to lay down your life and not be afraid if somebody's going to take control out of your hands, not being afraid if you're going to lose control, not being afraid if things are going to be taken out of your hands, and really learning to trust God. God, I trust you. This makes me uncomfortable, but I'm going to pull down my thoughts. I'm going to shut down. I'm going to tell my own thoughts and my emotions to be quiet and to settle under the peace and the patience of God and to get into alignment with what God says, that he is in control and he's the one that's taking care of my whole life. And if I obey him, if I follow him, then I will prosper. It doesn't matter what I have to lose. If I have to lose in this earth, if I have to lose in this world, then I'm going to gain. And he says, you know what? You're not only going to gain in the world to come, but he also says you're going to gain in this life. He says in this life and the world to come, if you're willing to lose it all. He didn't say I'm going to make you lose it all. I think we sometimes forget that. We misunderstand. He doesn't say I'm going to make you lose it all. He just is saying I need you to be willing to lose it all. I need you to be willing to give everything over to me. Because when you can do that with your whole heart and say, I'm willing, if I have to get under the ground, if I got to be so low that I am just undone before you, I'm willing because I want you to know, Jesus Christ, that if you don't matter, then nothing else matters. If you are not pleased, then nothing else is a concern in my life. We have to get to that place where it doesn't matter if I'm pleased. It doesn't matter if I'm happy. It doesn't matter if I'm satisfied. If God is satisfied, he's going to satisfy me. If I have peace with God, he's going to give me peace and he's going to even make my enemies at peace with me. Do you believe that? You know, you don't believe that. The reason why you know you don't believe that is because when this happens over here, you respond that way. When you have this emotion or this thought concerning that, then you follow it and you then begin to think about it and you think, well, what if this and that? And you keep going down that trail of thoughts. So the enemy is just trailing you along. He's trailing you along into a trap and you go there. Because you believe what you can see and what you can hear in front of you greater than what you can see and believe as far as what the Lord is saying. So the question that we have to ask ourselves is, do we really believe God? Do we believe that he has our best interest in mind? Because there is an example, there's several in the Word of God, but the one that we brought up in our conversation was Ananias and Sapphira. You know, these people, they agreed with their lips that Jesus is Lord and I'm willing to give all. But when it came down to it, they were willing to lie. They were willing to hold back. They were willing to be selfish. They were willing to walk in fear. They were willing to second guess. They were willing to disrespect and to dishonor. They were willing to preserve their own lives, thinking that God did not see. They thought that God was unaware. And even if they knew that God was aware, they thought they had more time. Even if they knew God can see, they thought, you know, he'll forgive me. Even if they thought to themselves, you know what? I know God is God, but he's not here. And he's going to give me more time to work on these things. He's going to give me more. He's going to understand my fear. He's going to understand why I can't or why I don't. They didn't realize how serious God is. They didn't realize how important it was. See, if I, God, love you to the extent that I will give to you my anointing, I'm sharing myself with you, my very presence, I'm sharing with you. I'm pouring out my glory on you. Most people don't get to experience that. Most people don't even know what that means as I'm speaking it right now. Most people have never even felt the glory of God beyond possible chills on their arms. Most people have never seen angels. They've never experienced the power of God, the shaking of God. They've never seen. They never had dreams and visions. They've never interpreted. They've never known what it is to hear the voice of God. Most people don't. And yet, if that's you, you can seek after it. You go after God because he wants to allow you to experience his presence to that degree and more. And at the same time, those that have been made, they've seen the beauty of God. They've experienced the glory and the power of God, and yet still on the inside are afraid to make those changes. You know, it really hurt my feelings. A few weeks ago, someone came to me, and it wasn't as though I've never heard of this before, but they were talking to me about a pastor that they met, and they were talking to the pastor about a certain property, and the pastor says, you know what, let me meet this other pastor friend that I know. They may be able to help you also with your pursuit. And this is a story that I'm hearing. And as the third party who told me the story began to meet up with these people and began to engage them and also see them engaged, they began to see this was not just a brother and sister relationship between two people of faith that were holy before the Lord. These were people that, regardless of their marital status, they were willing to flirt with each other and have extramarital interactions, even if it just were emotional, because of their relationship as pastors. Male, one female, their relationship as pastors. They have something in common. They interact good, well enough. And so this was their relationship on top of or underneath, undercovered. You know, there's a scripture that talks about the hidden things of dishonesty. That really hurt my feelings. I've heard of these things and I know these things happen. But to get hit in the face and realize that, you know, there are so many people that make excuses for the little areas that are really big areas. They make excuses for why it's okay. But the Lord says, you know, if a man even looks upon a woman to lust after her, he's committed adultery in his own heart. And we need to understand that adultery is not first about and against the person that you may be in relationship in the flesh with, but it is adultery against the Lord. And he says, I see what's in your heart. And adultery first starts there. And he says, know ye not that those, and he gives a whole list in 1 Corinthians. He gives a whole list, these, and adulteries are in one. He says, you will not enter in. And he's not even just talking about those that are fornicating. Fornicators are a part of that list. Fornicators will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Go and look at that list. You will not enter in if you are comfortable with being a fornicator, if you are comfortable with lusting after people and living a lustful lifestyle, if you are comfortable with things that you know God hates, if you are comfortable with adultery in your heart, if you're comfortable with the little lies and the small areas of manipulation in order to get your way, if you are comfortable with holding unforgiveness toward people, he says, listen, I cannot wink at these things. It's not in me. I'm holy and I am more true to my own name than I am to yours. I am faithful to you as my people. I am loving, I'm gentle, I'm kind, I'm merciful, but I am more faithful to my own name. God says he's faithful to his own name, as holy and righteous than he is to us. Which means it's a blessing because we get to strive for his holiness. And when he pours out his grace and his power, we get to say, Lord, okay, help me to obey. Strengthen me in my areas of patience and my areas where I can bridle my tongue and where I can love better and I can get rid of the bitterness and I can pay more attention and I can hear when my speech is bitter and I can hear when my speech is unloving and I can hear when that was prideful, it was not humility. And when I do use sarcasm and when I do lie, I can be convicted of it instead of continually lying day after day after day and having things in my phone and I know that I'm scrolling and I know I'm glancing at, but nobody knows. And you know what? I have no conviction about it, knowing that it's sin, knowing I'm watching these things, knowing I'm scanning them. Just because you turn down the audio, you're seeing the video, you're taking it all in, and you have no conviction of the Holy Spirit. All of these things, he says, listen, you're committing adultery in your heart against God. And you don't know if you have more time. Just because I allow you to experience my power, Ananias and Sapphira, the reason why they agreed from the beginning that they would give everything is because they experienced God on levels they never had experienced before. And yet they then too experienced a consequence that they did not know was coming. They didn't know that that was their day because they thought they had more time. They did not fear God enough. They didn't fear God. They had things on the inside. Maybe they were afraid to lose. Maybe they had lost some things. Maybe there was some brokenness on the inside where they did lose some things. Maybe they had experienced measures of bondage. Maybe they had a child that they lost and it really hurt them. Maybe they did have an abortion and they regretted it and they just really were still dealing with the pain of it. Maybe they were experienced abuse. It could be domestic abuse. It could have been child abuse in the past. Maybe they had matters where they didn't trust their leadership, their current leadership, because they had issues with church leadership in the past. You know, the temple priests, maybe they had stolen from them or they misguided them or they misused them. And so they didn't know if they could trust their new leadership. The Lord did not use that as excuses. He did not accept those as excuses for them to linger in their brokenness any longer. He says, I have given you grace, not only for you to wear me on the outside, but for you to allow for me to come in on the inside and to work out those things in you that are not clean before me, that are unholy, the areas of you that make excuses, the areas of you that say, I still have time, the areas of you that don't want to put forth the effort to continue to allow God to do the work, because it might hurt or it might take some time or he might ask you to fast. He might ask you to go in outside of your comfort zone and do something you don't want to do. He might tell you to take off work for a few days and to spend time in his presence. And you may not know how to pray or what direction he may take you in. He may tell you to walk on waters and you don't know what's underneath the surface. He might. And it might be scary. But we have to ask ourselves, do we trust the Lord? And are you willing to risk it all? Because if you are willing to give it all, then you're going to be given all from Jesus. But if you try to hold on, you're going to lose everything. You're going to lose. And so don't risk it. You and I, we have an inheritance, not just in the life to come, but we have an inheritance now in this earth. That he promises to us some access. He promises peace in our lives. He promises us goodness. He gives you access to the hearts of people around you to begin to win souls for him. He gives you access to begin to overcome the small matters of life that you encounter every day. He empowers you to have the earth, to take over. He empowers you in order to win the earth for Jesus. But you can only do that if you are living for him. And then at the same time, what good is it for a man to gain the whole world and to lose his own soul? You don't want to lose out. You don't want to miss out. You don't want to lose everything. So gain the whole world, and also let Christ gain your soul throughout it all. That's our goal. We have to know that it's not the same. If the Lord rains down his power, if you experience his word and it's sharp and it's great and you understand it and you experience the power of God, you experience his word, you experience the joy of his presence, his laughter, you have all of these things. That is not the fullness of it. Allow God to go deep under the covers and make you who you are called to be. Make you so full of love that nothing offends you. How about that? Make you so full of peace that you're able to be that peacemaker. And you can know that you're full of peace because when you speak and you engage people outside of you, when they are going through things in their mind and their emotions that are hard, you bring peace. You can see peace. You can see the shifting in them. And then they're drawn closer to you. You know, especially when you have a close relationship, especially if they're a child, they're your children. Can you do that? Try that. Can you do that? Or do you make it worse when you talk to them? Do you have peace on the inside? Is there real joy? Do you have enough oil? Do you have the presence of God on the inside? Or was it like a raincoat for you? When you speak to your spouse, do you have it on the inside? Because you'll know based on your outcome, you'll know. You can have the power of God, but you need to have some evidence that it's on the inside. It's not just about what you feel and what you experience. It's about what the Lord sees. And then you'll know based on your impact. You'll know based on what's going on the inside, what flows out of you. All of these are keys. It's not just one way for you to know. You should be looking at several keys. It's like a treasure hunt. They give you several different keys for you to know one answer. One answer. I got to keep going. Somebody really got me the other day with a baby reveal. How many steps do we need to get to? I just want to really know what the baby is, right? I really just want to know. Well, in the same way, it's the glory of God that conceals a matter. But it is the honor of kings to search it out. So you and I, we have the privilege to search out what's on the inside. We have the privilege to know that there are inward, deeper matters that we have to be concerned about to make sure, do I really have a fear of God or do I just think that I do? Do I just say that I do? What's my evidence? How do I behave? Am I gentle? Am I meek? Am I patient? Am I willing to let go of bitterness? Am I willing to walk in the love of God even though I'm offended, even though things are hard, even though I have to continue to go through the same things? It seems like it. It seems like I keep coming home to the same things. Am I still willing to engage the Lord even as I engage people? He says, like, you can't just love me. You got to love the people around you. And that starts with the people closest to you. You can't avoid them. You can't overlook them. You can't push them to the side. If you love God, then your real love for God is how you're able to love people. And those first people are right on the outside of you. So that's how you practice. Your spouse, can you do that? Your children, can you do that? Your nieces and nephews, can you do that? Your neighbors, can you do that? You know, they woke you up in the middle of the night. Can you do that? When you have a tormenting dream, can you wake up and still be loving to the people around you? Can you still act in patience and peace and endurance in your life? What's on the inside? What's on the inside of you? Is there power on the inside, or did it just kind of rain on the outside and then just drift off? Because I'm telling you, I saw some beautiful things as I was out and about today. It was beautiful. It was beautiful. It really, really was. And I had no idea that behind the cover of all of these things, that there are people who are experiencing some really ugly things. Some really ugly things. But I was grateful because then I know how to pray. Now I get to address them because that's why I'm here anyway. That's why I'm here. I'm not here to just take in the beauty. That's like a dessert. Yes. But when I come to sit at the table with Jesus, he's gonna present to me some matters and he's gonna say, okay, I want you to address this with me. So all of these things are here. I didn't know that. But now that I know how to address them, because with the Lord and with his power and his grace on my life, I can take authority over these concerns because they are concerns of the Lord. And when he puts them before me, he says, I'm going to perfect the things that concern you. And I say, thank you, Lord, because you know what? I needed you to do that because I don't have the power to impact these areas and to make change, but you do. And so I need to be the type of person that is what I see on the outside as far as the glory of God and his power, what I'm experiencing, that that's what's going on the inside. And the way that I know is not just because I have gifts, but because I have fruit. And I don't just have fruit that after a while it gets worn out and beaten and bruised and gets tossed out, but I have fruit that remains. Because I'm connected to that vine. And the vine is the one that is addressing me. And he's washing me. And he's strengthening me. And he's continually helping me endure and be patient. He's connecting me with the right people. And he's washing the wrong people out of my life. He is the one that's helping me to have the right words. And to make peace with all men. He's the one that's giving me the salt that I need when it seems like it's wearing out. He's the one that's refining me. And he's allowing his rivers to wash over me and give me the joy that I need when I didn't expect to encounter things in the day. He's the one. He's the one when I am not sure if I want to give it all because of fear. He's the one when the experiences in my past come back up and it causes me to come to a standstill and I'm not sure how to go forward. He's the one that gives me that extra push. And so he's the one that gives me the gift. And so he's also the one that's going to help me to bear that fruit that remains as long as I am open and willing. Gotta have an open mind. I gotta have an open mind. I gotta pay attention when I am actually exemplifying fruit that is rotten. I need to be sensitive to that. I need to have a conviction of the Holy Spirit on the inside so that I know that the Lord is not only working on the outside. You can be a man. You can be a woman. I'm glad. Be that man of God. Be that woman of God. But at the end of the day, your soul better be clean. So that's what we're going to do. Have your gifts. Have your gifts. Have your anointing. But your personality on the inside, let it match with Christ. In Jesus' name.